First of all, I thank everyone for coming out tonight. My name is Toby Ruth, I'm the director of Franklin High School. And we'd like to welcome each of you, students, parents, staff, coaches, former coaches, members of the media, most importantly, our honored alumni, who we will be inducting into the third class of the Franklin High School Athletic Hall of Fame. First, I'd like to thank these people who spent a lot of time to make this possible. First of all, I'd like our administration, Ms. Dickerson, Dr. Pantol, Mr. Rugg, Mr. Eubanks, and Ms. Pat. Their unwavering support is still with us to that will not only continue to Franklin High School's long-standing tradition of excellence, but propel that success forward for all of our future Rebel athletes. Secondly, tonight, I'd like to thank FHS senior Joe Critchlow, and he's our starting quarterback who could not make it tonight. He's out there getting mentally prepared. But Joe was on the verge of helping us someday in the Hall of Fame this past summer for his Eagle Scout project. He spent many hours researching information, finding old photographs, and putting together the plaques that will adorn the Hall of Fame for years to come. I've had the privilege of coaching Joe in basketball the past two seasons. Off the field and off the court, he's both an outstanding student and a fantastic young man. I'd also like to thank Cecilia White and her job as class. She spent the last 2 weeks dusting and cleaning all is both amazing and it's just unbelievable, all the people who have come through here. And so each one of you are being inducted tonight. First of all, I'd like to thank you for taking the time to come out here, but I'd also like to congratulate you on the successes that you've had and the honor of representing the school for years to come. Now I turn over to Dr. Shane Hanson, who's our first principal and a former FHS teacher and coach, who was instrumental in developing the Hall of Fame.
This is a very, very brief history of Franklin High Hall of Fame. When I came to Franklin in 2000, we were 10 years away from hitting our 100th anniversary, and one of the ideas, you ever had an idea where you want someone else to implement the idea, you just want to come up with a suggestion? So one of the things came up was that as we were getting ready for our 100th anniversary, that we would build a Hall of Fame. And I talked to Ms. Dickerson, and Ms. Dickerson said we could have it for all that I created. So we went to work, formed a committee, and actually put together a book about the 100th anniversary of Franklin High. We realized we had a tremendous amount of very, very successful teams and athletes that had been through Franklin High, but we didn't really have a record of it. We didn't have it anywhere in the building, and we moved into this building in 2006. So we decided to take the longest hall that we could find and make it our Hall of Fame. So as you walk down the Hall of Fame, it didn't start off as a lot of big ideas. It was just a place for us to celebrate individuals, but then we wanted to make sure that we celebrate our teams. And if you walk down this Hall of Fame, and eventually it's going to have to wrap around, because over 100 years, you can only imagine how many successful teams we've had and how many we better continue to have, is that's going to continue to grow. But I want to thank you for being here tonight. It's such a night for me because a lot of you going into the Hall of Fame tonight. I even had you in class. I promise you we're only going to tell positive stories tonight. But it's really, really neat to see you guys out in high school here tonight. And really special night for class 1963's basketball team over there. They want to take on the state champion team immediately following this. So we're having a good 3-on-3 matchup or something. I want to thank you for being here. I want to thank you for taking the time to support our school, but I do hope that is welcome to you at any time. We're a community school, we want you to stop by anytime. If you've been here a while, you know our zone keeps getting smaller and smaller. People keep selling their houses to be in our zone, which speaks well of our school. But we hope you'll be here. Several of you, I see, you haven't had kids here in over 20 years, but you come back to football games on Friday night, you're at baseball games, you're at soccer games, you're everywhere. And that's really what makes Franklin High a special place. So without me rambling on anymore, I want to go to Coach Ruth to come up and introduce the team.
Ridiculously tall, very dark pants on. Alright. Our first group of teams this year. This is the first time we've done that, and it was a difficult process, except for the girls' soccer program, and it's actually difficult to leave some of them out. And we're gonna save some for later. Hopefully we'll keep adding some more. We have a fantastic girls' soccer program. So to get this off the roll, I asked Gary Schrader to come up and introduce first against the nine teams, Franklin High School. Gary Schrader is here.
Well, first of all, I've been given 5 or 6 minutes to talk about the nine state championship seasons, which is a difficult challenge. And it also shows that Coach Ruth doesn't really know me that well, because I've got lots of stories and can tell many about each team. And so I was really thinking, how can I sum this up? And so the teams that are coming in, first of all, we have the 84 and 85 team, and soccer was actually sanctioned in 1986 by the NCAA, which was when I first started coaching. And there were actually four teams, so there's two teams, and I want to make sure they were mentioned. The 82 team was 6-0-2, and the 83 team was 8-0, but there wasn't really a state tournament. And so we might need to get those teams in later. But then the 84 and 85 teams were both undefeated, and there was a state tournament that wasn't sanctioned by the NCAA. And then the 86 would have been the first year that it was sanctioned by NCAA when I started. And so we won. We did not win in 87, even though we lost in the state finals 2-1. That's pretty good. And then we won it for 5 more years up through 93. So those are the teams that are coming in. Out of those teams, just a few numbers. There were 5 nationally ranked teams. Now, according to some of the any of the sports we're going to talk about, you don't become a great player without many times to tell. But I'll be glad to have done some other. I can tell lots of stories. I'm not sure that they're true. So I try to say when I tell a story, that's the way that I tell it. I'm sure they've gotten better over the years. But there's lots of memories of good times. And I say a lot. The question people probably ask me the most, and I don't know, a principal and I'm not coaching, is do you miss it? And I do miss it. And the one thing that's different about coaching from teaching and being a principal is that you get close to a small group of students in a way that you can't as a teacher of class or principal of a school. And those bonds stick together. Even tonight, some of these girls that walk up that I haven't seen in years, the relationship is still there the same as if it was 20 years ago right out here before we go to practice. And I'm sure the guys from the 1963 team and 1819, those guys would say that they still have that bond. And then the final thing I'd like to say, and I know some of you have heard me say this before, but it's just so fitting. I have to use it. I read a book about a football coach, and they asked the coach, how's your team going to be this year? The reporter was asking him and said, ask me in 20 years, and I'll tell you. And the reporter said, what are you talking about? He says, come back in 20 years and tell me and ask me what kind of team I had this year. And when I can see these players, when they're productive members in the community, when they're good parents, when they're teachers and doctors and lawyers and making a difference in this town, then I can tell you what kind of team we have. And so now, I feel lucky. Actually, the 20 years has turned into 30. But now, 29 years down the road, I'm getting to enjoy seeing that come true. And again, I'm sure that's going to be true about the other teams that we talk about, that it's just very meaningful to me. And, you know, a lot of people say they don't like Facebook. I love Facebook because I get to see my players on there and I get to see what they're doing and see that their parents and what their jobs are. And that's probably what I'm most proud of. So at this time, I would like the members of any of those teams that are here to stand. We have a few. Thank you very much. At this time, we need to remember those girls' soccer team. Y'all would come up to the front. I can't pass on the picture of the little certificate. We'll get a picture real quick. So, anybody from the 84 and the 92 girls' soccer team? Father, certificate or two. Mr. Jerry Brandon, former FHS basketball coach, 1963. Can you come up and talk about these guys a little bit?
Guys in, and then people out of town.
Tennessee State, Tennessee A&M at that time. And was lucky enough to be in quite a few coaching clinics with him. And as a young coach, that was so important. And the other thing I might say, the school spirit, the community spirit, was so outstanding. We had a gym, I'm not sure how many you can see, I think 1,800 or 2,000. Well, I've noted that on different occasions it would be 2,000 tickets sold. We had a great support from the community and students, and it was a fun time. Let me just briefly tell you about the team. I came here in 1959 as a young coach, but these guys came in as freshmen, so we kind of grew up with that. And it meant so much to me to work with these guys over here, because not only their basketball ability, but the character that they would show throughout their period of time, and under different situations. Now, not only were they really good basketball players, and most of them actually make the honor roll. I wish I could take the time to go over with each individual, because they were so, not only successful in school and on the basketball floor, but they were so successful in life, and it's so important to me to still be a part of their lives. They were given the name. You've got to realize that there in 1963 we had two newspapers in the National and the National Tennessean, and we didn't have the Titans or the Coot Springs Mall, so we were able to get a lot of people and a lot of names from not only across Winston County, but across the state. And we played before a lot of people. We didn't win the state tournament in 1963. But I was informed, and this was at Vanderbilt, and it was before they had added the upper decks, and we had the largest crowd that had ever watched a high school game in a state tournament. And I think it was like 6,500 at that time. So these guys had the ability to learn about. Let me just take a second. I know we have a lot of teams. Three guys that make it here tonight. Don Alexander was a sophomore on the team. He didn't play much, but he's a big part of the team. Don. Terry Gladney. If we'd have had a 3-point play back then, this guy was a shooter. We averaged like 75 points a game. If we'd had three, we might have won what we had. I've got to tell you a story about this team I'm talking about the Mount Storm. I'll never forget. One team decided to run with us one time. And the score at the end of the first quarter was 38-20. Can you imagine in an 8-8 quarter score 38 points? So that was a fun time. Now, I'm sure these guys remember that. I won't mention the team that we did that against. We wasn't like that. But Terry Gladney, Devin Davis, he was a quarterback. We didn't call him point guard back then. That's what he was. And we couldn't have had success without him, because he distributed, he was a coach on the floor, and it was just a fun time. I want to thank you for being just a little part of the Franklin High School history. It meant so much to the team over the years. And, so thanks again.
Yeah, it's a couple of big pictures.
Give us a minute to get up.
No, the gym is gone, but like we're still using the same locker room. Next, I'd like to bring up more Franklin High School, Brett School. 93, 94 girls state tournament teams. Doug Crozier.
I'm going to do this in order of program, and then say first, it's good to be home. I became principal of Franklin High School on July 5th, 1988, and served from June 30th, 2012 years. I was a part of serving the state championship teams, and quite rewarding. I will start off with this first, the 89 AAA state champions. I will tell you that team was meaningful enough to me that a couple of years ago I would not have had a custom ring made the 1989 state champions. The record was 37-2. They were good. They were very good. And they were very talented. That they were probably not the most talented team in the state. Because I think some of our kids overachieved. But don't make any question about it as far as playing together. They played as well together as any high school basketball team I've ever seen. But I'll also say, in my 12 years here at Franklin High School, if I think the four or five best athletes that were here when I was here, two of them were on that team. That would be Kevin Anglin and Van Gogh Richard.
Yay!
Let me mention briefly Coach Joe Davis, now deceased. Joe was the epitome of your old school basketball coach. The first day I met Joe, sometime in July, I was sitting in the office trying to figure out what to do. I had been a principal before. I can't do it like I was an assistant principal. Joe came in, and I thought, here it goes. We're going to start with the coaches. We've got to have uniforms. We've got to have this. We've got to have that. And all the guys I still know, in my 12 years here at Franklin High School, I probably bought 20 sets of basketball uniforms. Like that change every year. That. But Joe came in and met me, and he said, Mr. Coker, he said, there's something I need for the basketball program. And I said, okay, fine. What's the latest? He said, I want a commercial washer and dryer. Joe Davis, which of course, the school ball boy. The players, in my understanding, they never took the uniforms on. When they showed up on game night, their uniforms were hanging in the locker. Joe was very, very meticulous. When he walked on the floor in the other gym or here, he would have a white towel draped around his shoulder. He didn't get real excited when he was ball game. And if you had asked him about it, he would say, I didn't mind coaching in practice. By the time you get out of here, you know, there's not much I can do. But he was an outstanding coach. He had two stays here at Franklin High. The first one was 5 years, where he won 125 games in 5 years. And then he came back to hiring again, and he coached for 2 more years before retiring from coaching. But coming down the stretch, first, I remember the subset game against Hillsborough over the old gym. We would have been about 33-2 at that time. Nine points down, 3 minutes left. And I thought, this is special. Even though we'll not get to win the second turn, you know, we would have outstanding season. Well, all of us are standing Kevin Anglin outside, along with his teammates. And his teammates knew where the bread and butter was. And if I'm not mistaken, the next 11-point Franklin scored, Kevin Anglin scored 9-1. First round of the state tournament, we faced Memphis Northside. They come in 35-5, we come in 34-2. There's no doubt because we in Memphis that they play a much, much better state than we did. But we took them down. Semifinal show, Mary basketball game. Took them down. Finals, twice straight. Three Division One players. They went home to have head down to the end of the country for one in 1989 state tournament. I would like this time to recognize the four that I see here, and just please stand briefly, Kevin Hackett, Kevin Wallace, Lee Little, and the only non-senior starter, the point guard, he was a junior, Jay Johnson. And one of the best athletes this school has ever had, Van Dover.
Saturday afternoon, we got
took that down to you, and I made one amendment. And so we came back from there, proving that we could play at a league level, and in fact, sports writer the New York Times quoted in the paper by saying he was the fastest girls soccer team he had ever seen. And folks, I would tell you, the girls in the soccer program, they literally looked like a fast track. They were a basketball fast track when they came down. I mean, if he was slow, he couldn't play around. Number one thing he had to be around, if he couldn't, he had to be fast. Are you gone? That was it. And that's still a standard. This evening we have two women's girls soccer coaches in Tennessee, both of us with us. Gary Strachan, who's both, and Jimmy Burson down at Burner Coach. No two men have won more soccer matches in San Tennessee. Once again, thank you very much for inviting me. Very meaningful to me. I put 100 years at Franklin High School, and as far as I'm concerned, this is still the flagship school of Weems County. Thank you.
This year, but my senior year, I've got to devote fully to basketball. So she was a junior. She hadn't played soccer since she was 10. She did not allow a goal the entire season. We were not even scored a goal. And I think that's very impressive. Thank you.
Thinking about basketball, you know where he knew where he stood every day. Has his keys in his hand, standing leaning against the wall. But I don't mention about the 89 basketball team. I thought it was unique. They lost one game in Texas, I believe, where you had a lady standing up counting the 5 seconds down. I don't know if many of you have been in the gym, but I think it was that day, whatever, the scoreboard, the clock broke. So you had a lady at Dixon stand 10, 9. You can imagine if you've been in Dixon's gym twice as big as this. So if you're, the moral of that story is to play a tight home game, break the clock, and have a countdown the seconds yourself. And now, thank you, Mr. Crozier, for being here. We're going to move on very quickly to Mr. Ruth. But I see Jimmy Burchett over there. Jimmy Burchett's assistant coach. Isn't that correct? With Jerry Bryant. So how many of you knew that? How many of you were alive in 1959? Okay.
boys basketball team up here.
Where is your 89 best team?
Induction into the Western Hall of Fame is indeed a great honor. It is one we reserve for those we consider to not only be worthy participants of athletes and sports models of great character and stature. In welcoming our new member into the Hall of Fame, we thank him for the pleasure he has given, for the example he has shown in his career that have underlined exactly what we should expect and want from our greatest sports people. He has exemplified courage, commitment, and above all, sportsmanship. He has brought us pride and has helped us hold on to a sense of place. Our Hall of Fame is an essential part of who we are and what we are proud of all of our members. For your success and for your dedication on behalf of sports, I congratulate you, the members of the Hall of Fame 2014. Throughout your dedication, your quest for perfection, and your wonderful spirit, you have made a mark of passion, pride, and history. We admire you, honor you, and like the ancient Roman, we salute you.
All right, next we have Dr. Pants. I'll go talk again and speak about our next two inductees, Jeff Hall and Aaron Parker.
Jeff Hall cannot be here tonight. He is in Tulsa, Oklahoma. After an exhaustive search, I thought Jeff was in the CIA or something. Life and taking different ways through sports. And I want to go through a couple of things. Jeff entered Franklin High School as a freshman. He had been a county champion at Grassland Middle School all 4 years here with golf. Jeff had won every match, led every match. And then when I got here, he was a sophomore. So sophomore, junior, and senior year, he won every match we played in except for one. And he was all district MVP, won every award that you can win for us here. He was the second player at Franklin High School that ever qualified for the state tournament all 4 years. Jeff went on to the University of Memphis. After Memphis, he played on some minor tours, and he has caddied the last couple of years. He's caddied at the Masters and caddied at the U.S. Open. And the thing for Jeff, when I say he led all but one, Jeff locked his keys in his car when they were in the bag inside. That's the only match Jeff didn't win in practice. So if you remember the old Carter Country Club, Jeff pulled in, locked his keys in his car with his club in there, and his mom couldn't get out there to lock his car fast enough, so we had to play the match. And that's the only match Jeff never won. So he had a great streak there. But Jeff was one of those guys, if you knew Jeff doesn't talk. Jeff were here, he wouldn't talk. He's the quietest guy, carries himself real manly, but he doesn't talk. So I would probably, if Jeff were here, I'd have to talk, because Jeff would not tell you what he's won. And one of the things that he did, we won the region, which was the only Franklin team so far, I think it's gone on to the state. He actually won the region with Jeff caring for that particular day. He shot 61. And if you play golf, you know, she was 61 in high school golf. Good. And he was just a day where he was phenomenal. And I actually think the University of Memphis was there, and I think I had the opportunity to start up that day. So if Jeff Hall is living in Tulsa, Oklahoma now. And like I said, I just want to acknowledge him, and I think his family now is moving out there too. So that's Jeff Hall. If you would, I know he's not here, but let's give him a round of applause. Sometimes in coaching, you're told by your principal that you're going to be coached and stuff. You may or may not want to coach. So I had a meeting. Ms. Dickerson has a way of just making me do stuff. So a lot of times with softball, it's one of those things where you, when you get a job, you got a coach. And most of my, half the softball team was my basketball team. So just kind of a natural fit. So in starting softball, you know, we had such a good group. And I go back to what Mr. Croce was talking about too. You think about athletics, 95% of relationships. Relationships amongst your parents, relationships amongst your team and the coaches. And it actually was a good year, good couple of years there for me to coach softball. And Karen Hargrove was a spectacular player for me when I was coaching. She was my shortstop. She started every game, basically, that we played. Actually, I think she started every game all 4 years of the year. So she's all district, won every award that we have here. Went on and played at Martin Methodist, took over their home run record. Was named Trans-South Player of the Year. She really won about anything that you can win in softball. And it was just a phenomenal time for me. It's a pleasure to see somebody be that good that you can make other people better. So with Karen here, I've known her family, I've known her for a long time. It's just really great to see somebody be rewarded for working hard. And tonight, Karen is here. She holds several records at Martin Methodist. She holds a skill between her and Lily Sutton, about every batting hitting record you can hold at Franklin High. Just a quick thing about Karen. If you've ever been around softball, they do all these cheers. It's weird. They don't, it's not like any other sport. If you coach basketball, you know, guys clap and stuff, girls. So softball, my first game coach of softball, they're standing on the bleachers. The dugout, yelling little raps or rhythm and stuff. They got everything rhymes and stuff. So that took a while for me to get used to. So once I kind of got over that, and then the next thing they did was, our bus driver was Gary Fuel. Great guy. But they had talked Gary Fuel into, after every game we won, that was away, get on the bus and we'd start just driving around the square, yelling. Just yelling at people, smell a mushroom, yelling at people. Yeah, we were just so excited. So my dad, which has retired now, but he had been around in education for about 42 years. I said, are you good with this? He said, oh, yeah, let him yell. Let him yell at everybody. So we got back to school and I asked him, I said, I cannot believe that you were okay with the whole team yelling. He said, something that stuck with me, he said, you're the head coach, not me. Then I realized, all right, so forgive me. So we would still drive around the square, but we would try to go, when we left the square, we'd drive like we're headed toward Page. And then suck back. And then that way everybody just thought we were from Page. We talk about how important parents are in the kids' life. And as I look around from 1963 team, and I know all the guys about 89 team, to the individuals that are going in tonight, you think about how your parents played a role. I can still hear Miss Joseph yelling. If I go to a baseball game, I can take where she's sitting. And in basketball, I think Corbin was playing, or Gary Wall was coaching, she'd be up here. You know, and it shows you're passionate about what you're doing. And you love it because you know, if you think about high school, it's one of the best times of your life in terms of getting to go out and play and do other things. So to wrap up with Jeff and Karen, I want to say I'm very, very proud of them for being in the Hall of Fame. Glad to have a small part of it. Glad that Karen's here tonight. Like I said, I don't know any awards she didn't win. She's just a phenomenal athlete. So Karen, if you'll stand up, let's give you a round of applause.
Thank you.
Kurt Jones, former Franklin High School teacher, current Independence High School assistant principal, who we are playing in just a few minutes on the football field. So, welcome, Mr. Kurt Jones, back to Franklin High School.
And I still remember the chicken dance more here that you used to do. It'll never, ever be on my mind in Syria. Coach Wilbur, thank you for being here tonight, and I recognize those throwback jerseys. I see number 3, 4 of them in this jersey, and there's 17 and 3 right there in the grade. So thank you for bringing those out tonight. That's a special honor. In 2002, when I moved here from Oklahoma, I was fortunate enough to meet these next two inductees. I moved here to pursue country music, and Willie Dickerson gave me an opportunity to begin teaching and coaching at Franklin High School. Little did I know that I would soon witness two of the most elite baseball players to ever walk the hall of Franklin High. I can truly say that these gentlemen were one of the driving forces in changing the culture of Franklin High School baseball and helping the program to its first state tournament appearance in school history. 4 district championships, 3 region championships, 3 sectional championships, and 3 state tournament appearances in the row. Not only are these two gentlemen former players, but they are close friends of mine. I consider them family, and it is an honor to introduce them to you. Caleb Joseph is a 2005 graduate of Franklin High School, where for his career he hit .422 with 35 doubles, 20 home runs, 117 RBIs. Now that's just 3 years. We then have his freshman year stats. Caleb was named the All-District 11 to the All-District Tournament Team, District 11 in 2003 and 2005. He is a career record holder in triples with 7. In 2005, he was named the Williamson County Player of the Year. He was the Tennessee Baseball Report's first team All-State, and he was a Tennessee Sports Writer Association first team All-State as well. Caleb chose to play his college baseball at Clemson University, where he hit .342 with 17 home runs in his 3-year career with the Bisons. Caleb was then to the A-Sun Atlantic Sun All-Conference team and led the Bisons to their first A-Sun Conference tournament and championship, subsequently earning him the Most Valuable Player Award for the conference tournament. In the 2008 first-year player draft, Caleb was selected by the Baltimore Orioles in the 7th round with the 206th overall pick. Caleb made his major league debut on May 7, 2014 and recorded his first hit on May 13. On June 22, Caleb hit his first of 9 home runs for the season, and on August 9, Caleb hit a home run in the Orioles' 10-3 win over the St. Louis Cardinals, making him the first Oriole catcher to home run in 5 consecutive games. In 2014, Caleb helped lead the Baltimore Orioles to the American League Eastern Division Championship for the first time since 1997, and the American League Divisional Series Championship by sweeping the Detroit Tigers. Caleb is married to the former Brooke Cannon, and they are expecting their first child and baby boy, this spring. Ladies and gentlemen, it's my honor to introduce to you the 2014 Franklin High School Hall of Fame inductee, Caleb Martin Joseph. He was named to the Tennesseans All-Mid-State team in 2006, 2007, and earning the Tennesseans All-Mid-State Player of the Year Award in 2008. He was twice named the Williamson County Player of the Year and three times named to the Tennessee All-State Baseball Teams. In 2008, Corbin was also named the Louisville Slugger Baseball All-American. Corbin holds a single-season record for home runs with 15, slugging percentage, and on-base percentage. And Corbin is also the Franklin career record holder for games played, at-bats, runs scored with 187, hits with 200, triples with 11, home runs with 37, runs batted in with 197, slugging percentage, on-base percentage, and total bases. His senior year, Corbin recorded a phenomenal 5-10 batting average with 15 home runs. My fondest memory of Corbin was during the 2008 season, his senior year at Centennial High School. We were down 2-1 in the top of the sixth inning, and Corbin walks up to the plate with a runner off first base. Now, any of you know anything about Centennial High School, they have this big cougar, concrete cougar in right field. And Corbin always seemed to have the knack of coming through in the clutch for his team or getting that little spark for his team. And it's no different at any level that he's played. That night, he was no different as well. He got up, got a pitch that he liked, and he drove one into the Cougar's mat. It's the longest home run I have ever seen in high school baseball. It was unbelievable. It was. Corbin committed to continue his education and play at the University of Kentucky for the Wildcats, but he chose to play professional baseball when he was selected in the 2008 first-year player draft by the New York Yankees in the fourth round with the 140th overall pick. Corbin made his major league debut for the New York Yankees on May 13, 2013 against the Cleveland Indians, and he got his first career hit with a double, sparking the Yankees hitters that day, and subsequently leading into a 7-0 win. Corbin is married to the former Emory Cochran, and they have a 5-month-old baby girl, Addie Time, who's here tonight. I can say without a doubt that Corbin Joseph is the best high school hitter I have ever coached and the best hitter I've personally seen in all my years of education. It is my honor to introduce to you the 2014 Franklin High School Hall of Fame inductee, Corbin Reese Joseph.
There were seven individual county championships, five county relay championships, She was all-county, all-region team, all 4 years. She qualified for the state finals in every event and relay that she swam at state. The lowest individual finish, even as a freshman, was third place at state, which is the highest level of state swimming, is the state meet. Her senior year, she won both her individual events at the county meet, the region meet, and the state meet. It's amazing, her career. I asked her parents what I might need to add tonight, and Kyle reminded me that in 2004, she was on the national junior team that went to Australia, and was quite exciting, and I feel like that set her up for her junior and senior years. Tracy reminded me that she broke her wrist her junior year and had surgery. She missed 1 week of practice. She's an incredible competitor. She also broke her foot in her senior year, but she continued to swim. Tracy, quote, still amazes me even though I've lived it with her. That's kind of the way it is to real to look back and realize that that all this was part of Sarah's career. She's now a national golf club and I work alongside of her there. She has a keen interest in sharing her passion for the sport of swimming with the next generation. And I'm proud to present Sarah Peterson from the class of 2006 to the induction ceremony here in 2014.
But she's a very skilled, red-headed
player by the name of Brittany Potts. The first goal that she scored was against Brentwood, who at the time had taken our spot as the lead in world soccer in the county. But from that time on, Brittany's name started to spread, that everyone could see what she would do and what she could do. During that first year, she became all-district, all-region, and all-state. This is all in her freshman year. All in all, she's finished second in team scoring her freshman and sophomore year. She was first in team scoring her junior and senior year. Our team record while she was Franklin High School was 68-10-4. She had career goals of 72, which is currently number 5 on the all-time list. Her career assist of 38 places her 7th on the all-time list. She was a 3-time team offensive most valuable player. She was a state tournament most valuable player in 2000. She was a 4-time all-district, region, and state player, and a 2-time All-American her junior and senior years. After graduating from Franklin High School, she received a scholarship to Ole Miss University, where she played all 4 years. It's been a great deal of pleasure. I'm sorry that she couldn't be here today, but it's a great deal of pleasure for me to recommend and accept Brittany Potts into the Franklin High School Athletic Hall of Fame. As I said, in 1998, things kind of turned. We're starting to turn course. And not only did we have a great freshman class in 98, we had another class that followed in 99. And in that class was a defender. Not just a defender. This young lady was probably one of the most intense players I've ever known and had a privilege to coach. I think she would probably rather break your leg than shake your hand on the field. She was just that tenacious. There was no way you were going to get around her. And in fact, her junior and senior year, our defense was so strong. This, for those of you that really don't know anything about the sport, most teams play with 4 in the back. We played 3. We didn't need 4. We had 3 good ones with Katie in the middle. That's all we need. But she wasn't only just a defender. Again, you don't know, most defenders don't do much scoring. But Katie was not only just a good player, she was a leader. And she was almost like a coach on the field. She could sense when our team was struggling offensively, which we didn't do often, but we did enough that she would take it upon herself that she was going to get their rear ends in gear. And she would make what we call defensive runs. The defender would make a run to the front, with the ball or without the ball, just anything to create havoc with the opposing team. I don't know how many times she did this. I do know that she was successful 26 times because in her career she had 16 goals and 10 assists, which is really kind of phenomenal for a defender. As I said, as a freshman, again, like Brittany became a star automatically as a freshman, so did Katie. She started all 4 years. Her freshman year, she was voted the team's most valuable defender. And for her career altogether, she was 3-time team defensive most valuable player and 1-time team most valuable player altogether, all just like a player from the year. 4-time all district and all region, 2-time all state. And after her senior year, she was selected All-American. Now, again, for those of you that are not familiar with our sport and the positions we have, a defender becoming All-American is like an offensive or defensive lineman becoming the most valuable player in the Super Bowl. That's just about how magnificent or magnetic it is for a defender to be an All-American. As far as I know, we have, there are only two in the state of Tennessee that have, two defenders that have ever been nominated or selected All-Americans, and Whiteman has to have both of them. After she graduated, she too received a scholarship to play college ball, and she played 4 years at Middle Tennessee State. In 1986, when Coach Schrader became coach in TAA sanctioned the sport, he introduced a slogan that is still used before every varsity game. And it's very simple, and I know that all of you have heard this. It's called the will to win. We should say, the will to win cannot be beat. Go, let's go. And the will, most people think, is just a desire. Well, Coach Strader put something together, and we get these out to our players. And just really briefly, the will to us is not only the will to win, it's not just a phrase, it's an emotion. It's never being satisfied, never letting your teammates down, being in shape to play full out 100%, having your mind in the game as full as your body, never give up, attitude, desire, determination, ambition, cooperation, courage, dignity, dedication, intensity, and a true love of the game. Anyone exemplified this slogan, it's Kate Brayton. She is a winner, period. And it gives me great deal of pleasure to introduce and recommend Kate Brayton as our 2014 inductee.
Mr. Logan's still here, he's going to take the picture for you.
Secondly, let me give about 20 minutes to do that, and lastly, come up to football field. And last 10 minutes before we kick off, I'm going to have you come to football field. We're going to reintroduce you to the crowd out here. And I'm really haven't been out there yet, but I'm hoping the stands will be packed, because this is a big game for us versus Independence. If you are an inductee, you don't have to pay to get in. So make sure that you guys come in for the past day over here on the South End. Thank you all so much for coming, and congratulations.